Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Rausan Pereira. In a bid to promote cashless transactions, the government on Friday said businesses with annual turnover of over 50 crore rupees can offer low-cost digital modes of payments and no charges or merchant discount rate will be imposed on them or their customers. Presenting the Union Budget for 2019-20, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman also said 2% tax deducted at source will be levied on cash withdrawals exceeding 1 crore rupees in a year from a bank account to discourage the practice of making business payments in cash. The Finance Minister said that the Reserve Bank of India and banks will absorb these costs from the savings that will accrue to them on account of handling less cash as people move to these digital modes of payment. Lately, digital transactions using mobile payment firms are on the rise. For instance, unified payments interface transactions have grown to 754 million in June 2019. IMPS and NETC transactions stood at around 171 million and 26 million respectively. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze India's thrust towards a cashless economy. Joining me on the program today are Ajay Dua, former Secretary, Ministry of Commerce and Industry; Banuchandar Nagarajan, former consultant, World Bank, Washington, D.C.; and A.K. Bhattacharya, Editorial Director of the Business Standard. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Mr. Bhattacharya, I'd like to begin the program with you. Before we look at, whether being a cashless economy is a boon or a bane, and before we talk about cashless economy as a whole, let's talk about what steps were taken so as to move towards a more cashless economy in the budget on Friday by Nirmala Sitharaman.
If I've got your question right, you want me to talk about the measures taken before the budget?
Yeah.
Well, to start with, the first big move that was taken, supposedly, was the demonetization. At the time of demonetization, in November 2016, our cash to GDP ratio was around 12% of GDP was that ratio. Now, immediately after demonetization, that ratio came down to around 9% of GDP, but it has grown steadily, I would say at a lower pace, but definitely steadily. And the latest, the 2019 end figure, shows that we are now at around 11% of GDP. So, in a sense, if demonetization, the proponents of demonetization are arguing that if demonetization had not happened, followed up with various measures to encourage digital transaction, credit card transaction, debit card transactions, increase in the number of point of sale machines, and also the introduction of mobile wallets like Paytm and PhonePe and all that, those things had not happened. The circulation, the money in the economy was growing at a rate of 14% every year. Now, certainly the growth of that, the money has come down, the pace has slowed down, and the digital transaction was around, let us say, in November 2016, was around 7 million total digital transaction. You mentioned about a few categories of it. If I take the total digital transaction thing, was in November 2016, it was around 7.6 million transactions, not the value. And that has gone up to around 21 million transactions. So
that's a three-time increase.
So I think it's a big increase. But what we need to be cautious about is that while moving away from cash is a good idea, but what we need to do to encourage that shift, that path is fraught with many challenges.
Absolutely, we'll talk about that.
Yeah. So that's the background, and the budget has got two different, focus on this aspect. One is a kind of a preventive measure, which is that it will not encourage you to withdraw money from your bank for cash payment more than crore in a year. And if you do that, there is no penal tax or anything, but it's just that there's a TDS which you can account for later on, which means you are coming out into the system, coming into the system.
Coming into the system, and basically you can be watched.
And the second part is a move to make sure that the merchant discount rates are reduced or eliminated to encourage more digital transaction. I find the second part is a little controversial, will be more difficult to manage. Because after all, use of point of sale machine and the use of non-cash modes should become an incentive in themselves.
Absolutely.
It should not result in a loss, or somebody need not be asked to absorb that loss. So I think we'll discuss all these things, but that's a broad background.
Broad background, really, as to this entire issue. Yes, Mr. Dua, let's talk about the second part that Mr. Bhattacharya was talking about now, and MDR, of course, and how will that change? How will that how will charging smaller companies as well, rather, or not charging MDR on smaller companies really help, and what's the way forward?
Let's recall that not too long ago, the Government of India, through the Ministry of IT, had come forward with a proposal and said that for cash transactions up to 2000 rupees, that means small transactions, there will be no cost. There will be, say, you may not call it MDR, but there is a fee which used to be levied. So they had said the government will bear it out of their own budget. And so we have petty transactions, let me call them petty, which are free, and in order to encourage people to make smaller payments or make smaller transactions already, Now, yesterday's...
There are several ads propagating the same as well on television.
Yeah,
we see them all the time. Yeah.
The second is with respect to the announcement made yesterday, which is that we would immediately, unlike the other incentive which you talked about, 2% TDS, etc., which comes in effect a little later, that transaction businesses with a turnover of above 50 crores a year are being incentivized, but second, they are being asked to follow a regime of offering payment options to their customers. It could be any UPI, you could be including, actually they are saying even debit and credit cards, RTGS, NIFT, and all the other Aadhaar Pay and other kind of systems. If they don't buy a particular date, then a fine penalty of 5,000 rupees a day has also been proposed in this budget, which means it is in a way mandatory, otherwise you get into the regime of non-compliance. To incentivize them, the government says, the RBI or the commercial banks, RTGS, NIFT, RTGS transactions go through the RBI. NIFT are internal in the banks, they would bear this cost, because now they have built up systems in which they were dealing with huge amounts of cash. Cash is coming down or will come down through these means, and that they should bear the cost.
Right.
The fairness of it, etc., the point we just raised, equity of it, let's leave it for the time being. Saying there was a cost, there is a saving to them, they are by and large, government, RBI, is an instrument of the government, so are the banks, PSBs. I think it might work to the extent of popularizing digital payments.
Mm. Mm.
It might also make it easier for companies or businesses which make large amounts of payments to daily workers. Say at the end of the day, a construction company is employed 100 guys. A logistics company, food delivery company pays its guys at the end of the day, whatever the basis it might be, 50 guys employed by a particular person. For every one of them,
right.
It was drawing cash earlier and pay them. Now, instead of that, what will happen is it will be a digital payment to them.
Absolutely. So it may work at some level is what you're suggesting.
And the exemption is for payments made to government departments, payments made to cooperative societies, payments made to, ATM users, not users, the guys who go to fill the ATM, ATM fillers, those kind of people have been exempted from it. The fact that we did see a sudden spurt in digital payments post-demonetization was actually showing us a potential of it.
Right.
And at the same time, a bit of a compulsion because there wasn't enough cash left in the hands of the in the market.
Right.
But by incentivizing it rather than, demonetization was a measure which was forcing some of these things to happen. Let the market go forward and let the regulations be clear. Like the government yesterday saying we will impose this restriction upon the company, I think is a good way forward, because now the way, though this has nothing much to do with internet, we are seeing that as 10% of the internet users in the world are in India.
Right.
We have the use of data. Some newspaper report today that per month use of data is 9 GB in India. That means there is a move towards going digital, going internet.
Absolutely.
I think we should be pushing it.
Absolutely. Banu, I'd like to bring you to the picture now. Talking about trying to popularize this mode of payment, going digital, going cashless, efforts have been going on for some time now. The government also incentivized it initially, brought out some very innovative new incentives. How has that worked? Should we rather move towards incentivizing in that way? Or what's the way forward?
As my fellow panelists just pointed out, the biggest behavioral change was affected by demonetization, right? So there were 18 trillion rupees in circulation approximately before demonetization. End of that fiscal, it was like 13.5. Now we are at 21.5. So if you draw a trend line, okay, you still can see that the cash in circulation now is probably less by around 4.5 trillion. I mean, analysts might differ, but approximately 4.5 trillion. That is one point. Okay. Second is, in 2013, the value of digital transactions was around 0.7 trillion. It is now 5 times, 3.5 trillion. Okay. So you see the amount of opportunity created by the 4.5 trillion rupee being less in circulation now, and the increase in digital transaction, right? First was demonetization. Second was the NPCI created the UPI. Okay, UPI actually is the payment platform in which funds can be transferred between banks effortlessly. So what it did was it created the digital infrastructure for private players to come and offer apps and offer payment services on top of it. That's why we see the PhonePe, the Paytms, the MobiQuicks, so on. Okay, other than Beam is also there, but private players also took advantage of it and they helped popularize it, right? So this is the state of play now. Now these companies are now moving into providing other financial services like insurance, like pension, pension transactions, so on and so forth. So not only did the government play its part by itself, but also it incentivized and provided a platform for private companies to come and provide other services. Now that system is being expanded using big data to provide credit. Okay, we need not just depend on the CRISIL credit score or something. Based on your transaction history, a person's credit score can be gauged. So that is how the big data and analytics bit how we can use big data and analytics to provide credit offerings. So this is the past and present. But Nandan Nilekani came up with a report last month in which he offered a glimpse into the future. So the thinking is so big. Okay. So PricewaterhouseCoopers came up with a digital transaction report in which they are saying that the number of digital transactions is going to multiply to like twice or three times though over the next 5 to 7 years at 20% CAGR. So, but Nandan Nilekani is saying that we are going to triple the value of transactions. Triple the value of transactions in the next couple of years. So there's a very ambitious target that is being set already. To achieve that, Nilekani proposes a lot of recommendations. There are 73 recommendations to the report, in which he says, like, you know, do a proper KYC. All government transactions should be done using digital payments. Government should facilitate payment of tolls, payment of buying railway tickets, payments to kisans, all of this digitally, so that we slowly start building this ecosystem and helping the rural customer come into the fold.
Right. Okay?
So the number of smartphones in India are also like going to increase manifold.
Sure.
Right now it is around 30%. So as it increases, the number of people that actually come and start using digital payments will also multiply.
Right.
So, like, there are other initiatives proposed, like where, like, they are. He asked the government to create CICO machines, cash in, cash out machines, instead of ATMs, which are now becoming very bulky, very difficult to build, establish, and maintain.
Sure.
Where in a cash in, cash out machine can operate with a SIM card, like ATMs required a broadband connection, so on and so forth. So what this will do is, the supply will itself create a demand. Okay, so just by the presence of these machines, more people will start using cards. Okay, and they will not just use the cards for using those machines; they will use it in other places as well. So there is a multiplier effect associated with this objective.
Sure.
So there are a slew of incentives. Like, in what has happened in the immediate past is like pushed this digital payments in a very big way. But we are actually thinking quite big in the next few years as well, in partnership with the private sector.
Absolutely. All right. So that having been said, Mr. Bhattacharya, so what are the benefits and what are the drawbacks of,
you know,
moving towards being totally cashless?
Benefits are quite a few. If you become cashless, it is not that any economy can ever be completely cashless. Cash will continue to play its role even in developed countries. The prevalence of cash has not been completely been eliminated, but the point here is that if you have reduced use of cash, clearly the compliance level at all level, you know, in various things is better. Recognition of economic activities get better, become more efficient. Government's tax collection machinery can be more efficient, but the larger question is, why do we have cash? Cash is necessary because it's a mode of transaction. Now the central question is that how do we make a switch from cash to digital transaction? In my view, the TDS on cash withdrawal above 1 crore in a year is a better way of moving towards a cashless economy than subsidizing imposing a financial burden on the private sector to take a hit and expect them to make compensatory gains fewer uses of people. I think people should be encouraged to use more digital transactions.
Right.
Because of the inherent advantages. And if cash is such a problem, then make sure that the use of cash is discouraged through various methods, like the one you have TDS on cash withdrawal for more than 1 crore in a year.
Right.
So, but to expect that the bank that works on a very thin margin will take the hit on your transactions because it is digital, or expect that companies above 50 crore will take the hit on their transaction, I think it is not fair. It is also not fair on the consumers.
Sure.
Because don't think that the company that is being forced to do this will not load this cost onto the consumers.
Yeah, at some point in time, it will come to the
consumers. It will come to the consumers.
Yeah.
So you are not really bailing out the consumer in any way. You are actually transferring the cost of this digitization onto the consumers finally.
Sure.
So I think it is better to think long term instead of setting targets like this. It is better to create incentive and disincentive structures by which people are automatically encouraged to move towards less cash and more towards digital transactions.
Absolutely. Yes, Mr. Dua.
You know, in 2005, when Mr. Chidambaram was the finance minister, we had a bank cash transaction tax. The 2006 collection in the budget showed 350 crores only had been collected by the banks for paying to the government on that account, which was not considered as, say, efficient or enough to continue the implementation of the program, and then given up till we thought about it again when the demonetization came, and now we are formalizing it through. It is going to be covering, good as it might be, as Mr. Bhattacharya mentioned.
No, that was not it. Cash transaction tax, I am not supposing. I am supporting. I think what has been done is not a tax. It is a TDS.
No, correct.
So cash transaction tax is a different thing altogether.
That was absolutely.
That is a strict no-no as far as I am concerned.
Absolutely. Yeah, what sure. I'm just I see that point.
Yeah, sure.
That's why I call the word TDS. The TDS, whether it will discourage. Or who is it going to be discouraging? How many number of people in the society or in the economy are going to be drawing 1 crore rupees cash from our account? Somebody wants you want to avoid the TDS? You probably have four banks in which you have accounts. You also have post office facilities separate. You have ways and means of avoiding that. One, the number is not too large. Second, there will be ways and means of avoiding even payment of that. So I'm just comparing that with the other alternative of moving to cashless society, which is the second option, the second proposal yesterday, and about which we are discussing, that businesses above 50 crores for making payments, they use the digital modes, which will apply to small people, which will apply to medium, which will apply to large. It is more based on transactions rather than the value of the transaction, number of transactions rather than the value, which here is 1 crore draw cash.
Right.
So you need to have both, not just one. That's my point. On that, why should you load them forever with the cost of giving or cost of paying the fee? Point very well taken, but I think the logic as of now is they have created the staff, they have created the infrastructure, which for dealing with cash, that comes down. In order to incentivize and pay out of our own pocket, looking at transferring it to them. I hope it's a temporary measure, and it's not forever. That's as far as this is concerned. I would think that the benefits are fairly huge. An estimate is that if you maintain a certain speed of going digital, the GDP impact can be 0.5 to 0.6% of the GDP, because a fair amount of unnecessary services, unnecessary infrastructure which gets created would not be required, and it doesn't probably add to the productive assets of the economy or the by itself to the GDP. Instead, you could be using it more gainfully elsewhere.
Absolutely. Yes, Balu.
So there are certain advantages of using tax in cash in use in small measures, right? Like, for example, security, privacy, urgency. There is no fear of cyber threats and so on. So these kind of discussions are not just happening in India. They're happening in Britain and UK as well, which is a heavy cash transaction rate. So, for example, in Britain, they are now worried about whether the poor and the elderly might be left out of the financial inclusion because of lack of education and lack of training in using digital payments. So this is not just an Indian problem, this is an international problem as well. So when we are trying to expand BharatNet, okay, which is the broadband connectivity to 2.5 lakh villages, once the project stabilizes and like we have a consistent broadband network and power connections, then certain infrastructure related risks can be mitigated. Okay, so this is an ongoing process. Though we actually talk about big numbers, the background infrastructure in expanding into rural areas is actually something that will happen slowly.
Okay. Right.
So that is something. But let me talk about international experience with Sweden. Okay, Sweden is like the mecca of cash transactions, in non-cash transactions. They have reduced transactions 50% in the last 10 years. Okay, and they're actually like now like the amount of cash used in transactions around 20%. In fact, like their three big banks have only like 25 branches covering a population of 1 crore. So like in all international discussions, Sweden is actually thrown out as the example. And I mean, which even developed countries are finding it difficult to emulate. But emerging market, China, actually has leapfrogged them. So in their WeChat, actually people actually send cash or cash equivalents. Mm. For example, recently in their the Spring Festival, the Chinese New Year, right? The amount of digital transaction that happened through WeChat, okay, it actually hit exponential numbers, and the system was not able to handle. So like something like that is yet to come into force in India. So WhatsApp has been trying it, but because of data localization issues, which is another big topic.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. That's a topic for another day and another time. Okay. I've got very limited time on the program, 1 minute left. So very quickly, closing comments from all my guests in one sentence. Mr. Bhattacharya, the best way forward.
My point is that this entire debate, the consumer must be at the center of the discussion. Unfortunately, the way it is being structured globally as well as in India, consumer is not necessarily always at the center of this debate. It is the digital companies who are at the center of the debate.
Sure.
I think we should move towards a cashless economy or reduced use of cash, but not at the cost of consumer confidence and consumer ease, but not necessarily, of course, for the ease of growing business of digital companies.
Sure.
So I think at the heart of the debate should be the consumer interest and nothing else.
Absolutely. Mr. Dua.
I would agree with you.
Okay, all right. And Banu, close the show for us with your concluding remark.
So actually, like, given our demographic dividend, the youthful population that we have, many of them are digital natives. They will actually get to using digital transaction quite easily than elderly people. And the expansion into rural areas will make us think big. Okay, and actually, I am quite happy about the private sector participation in expanding financial services to the various segments of our society. So the Nandan Nilekani report talks quite broadly about these, and most of the recommendations are very welcome. Hopefully the government acts in the next couple of years to make that a reality.
Absolutely. All right. With that, then we'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's it from me. See you again next time.